Ken is the author of two Chautauquan literary and scientific circle selections. His Archibald Cox, Conscience of a Nation, the authorized biography of one of the leading lawyers and public servants of the 20th century, won the 1999 Bruce K. Gould Book Award for Outstanding Publication Relating to the Law. Gormley's 2010 book, The Death of American Virtue, Clinton versus Starr, a New York Times best-selling chronicling the scandals that nearly destroyed the Clinton presidency, that received a 2011 Silver Gavel Award from the American Bar Association. Gormley has testified in the U.S. Senate 3 times. He also served as president of the Allegheny Bar Association, the first academic to hold that position in the organization's 137-year history. From 1998 to 2001, Gormley served as mayor of Forest Hills, Pennsylvania. Gormley earned his bachelor's degree from the University of Pittsburgh, summa cum laude, and his JD from Harvard Law School. Ken will speak on the 40th anniversary of the Nixon resignation. And with the young lawyer, and it says here, I'm sorry, Ben, it says not so young, who negotiated Nixon's pardon, and he will be accompanied and introduced Benton Becker. Thank you.
For the honor of joining you today, along with our special guest, Benton Becker, to discuss these historic events of 40 years ago, and also thanks to Shara Babcock for conceiving of this program. Incidentally, if you notice, we have the church lectern here, so this counts for church today. How many of you remember President Ford announcing the pardon of Richard Nixon? A few of you, okay. I've done a lot of work on this era in American political history. As Nancy mentioned, I had the privilege of writing the biography of Archibald Cox, the Watergate special prosecutor who became a hero for standing up to President Nixon in the Watergate affair. I consider myself especially fortunate that the Cox book became a CLSC selection. I gave my very first book talk here, right here in the Hall of Philosophy, in the summer of 1998. And since then, I've had the chance to give talks all over the country and other countries. But Chautauqua is still my favorite venue of anywhere I've ever been, and I can say that for my wife, Laura, and our kids, too. So thank you all for that gift. Observing the 40th anniversary of many historic events relating to Watergate, President Nixon's resignation from office took place 40 years ago this coming week, on August 8, 1974. When I talk about Watergate in law school classes today, I have to give a lot of background because most students weren't born in Watergate. Were any of you not born during Watergate? Okay, that saves us a lot of time. Rather than giving an exhaustive Watergate recap, I want to spend most of our time getting the story from Benton Becker. He was then the lawyer who negotiated this whole pardon deal with President Nixon. Mr. Becker and his wife, Joanne, who's up here, have come all the way from Florida to participate in this event in Chautauqua. Benton and I are going to do one more event next month in Pittsburgh, followed by the finale the month after at the Ford Library and Museum in Grand Rapids. So there are only a small number of people in the country who will get to hear this incredible story firsthand, and Chautauqua is the first. So let's take ourselves back to the summer of 1974, one of the most dramatic periods in American history. President Nixon's literally fighting for his life after winning an overwhelming re-election in 1972. He becomes engulfed by the Watergate affair. White House operatives had been arrested, if you remember, carrying out a burglary inside the Democratic National Committee headquarters in the Watergate Hotel in Washington. And now Nixon is implicated in covering it up and offering to pay $1 million of hush money to the perpetrators to keep quiet. So when Special Prosecutor Archibald Cox subpoenas 9 tapes to prove or disprove Nixon's complicity in the Watergate affair, Nixon just refuses to do it and fires Cox in the infamous Saturday Night Massacre. A firestorm of public protest erupts, and a new special prosecutor, Leon Jaworski, is appointed, who subpoenas dozens more damning tapes from Nixon's secret White House taping system. Meanwhile, President Nixon's vice president, Spiro T. Agnew, pleads nolo contendere to accepting bribes in little white envelopes. And all of a sudden, he resigns and is replaced by Gerald R. Ford, the House Republican leader, a Republican stalwart, someone who was preparing to retire, actually, at the time, was not expecting any of this. The final straw comes for Nixon with the Supreme Court's decision in U.S. v. Nixon 40 years ago this coming week. It unanimously declared that the president had to turn over the Watergate tapes. This led to the discovery of the infamous smoking gun, which revealed that the president had urged his chief of staff to halt the FBI investigation into Watergate, a clear obstruction of justice. There was also, remember this, the infamous 18 and a half minute gap in a tape. Nixon didn't know how it happened. Experts said deliberate erasure. So the drumbeat for impeachment grows louder, and the House Judiciary Committee, in a sober bipartisan vote, can you imagine this today, approved three articles of impeachment. On August 8th, after members of President Nixon's own party had come to the White House and told him they could no longer support him, a visibly shaken Nixon announced that he was resigning, and the next day at noon, he salutes and flies off in a green helicopter, and Gerald R. Ford, who'd been vice president for all of 10 months, becomes president of the United States. Within days of his taking office, journalists are peppering Ford with questions. Are you thinking of pardoning your predecessor, Richard Nixon? One of Ford's top advisors told me when I was working on the Cox book, Bob Hartman, that he advised Ford categorically not to do it. He said, your political future will be destroyed if you decide to run for president in your own right in 1976. You'll be shot to hell if you pardon Nixon. On the other hand, you have to understand that Ford had grown up with very modest means in the Midwest. He was actually the adopted son of a paint and varnish salesman in Grand Rapids, Michigan, put himself through college on a football scholarship, coached football to get it to get through Yale Law School, a square-jawed, straight shooter in the House of Representatives for 25 years. And now, after talking to his wife, Betty, and some very close friends, he concluded that pardoning Nixon may be the only solution. The country had become obsessed with Watergate. And if Nixon was criminally prosecuted, Ford was sure that the country would go through two more years of being dragged through the mud on this. And he, Ford, also would never get any of his own policy initiatives accomplished as president. So that's where the story begins today. Gerald Ford takes over the White House with only one day's notice. He's surrounded by aides and advisors who are primarily, think about this, Nixon loyalists. Chief of Staff General Alexander Haig, Attorney General William Saxby, these are the people walking the halls of Ford's White House. And in California, former Press Secretary Ron Ziegler, who's now being the handler for Nixon from afar. And in the midst of this hullabaloo, I have to tell you, is another big question: what the hell is going to happen with all of Nixon's records and tapes? These are key evidence in all of the Watergate trials of the Nixon's co-conspirators from the White House that are slated to go forward very shortly. There are only a few people surrounding Gerald Ford who he can trust. Bob Hartman, his chief speechwriter, Phil Buchan, longtime friend and now counsel to the president, and Benton Becker, another trusted colleague who's now special counsel to the president. Most of the people who were involved in this historic drama are no longer with us all these years later, but fortunately, one person still is very much here, Mr. Benton Becker, whom President Ford trusted implicitly, so much so that he summons him into the Oval Office to ask him to work out the pardon deal with President Nixon, an unprecedented event in American history. So I'd like Benton Becker to pick up the story here by telling us how events played out first in Washington, setting the stage for his historic trip to meet with ex-President Nixon in California. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great honor to introduce to you Attorney Benton Becker.
Let me start again with the background. Clearly, Richard Nixon had been in office August 9, 74, for a period of 5 years. During that time, there had been a substantial accumulation of documents, records, papers, and some 900-plus tape recordings of the made in the Oval Office and in the Executive Office Building next door in the President's office. They were voice-activated tapes. Many of them were not heard, and Richard Nixon had them prepared for transmittal during his presidency. Before he left office, they were boxed, they were taped, they were had archival references on each box so everyone knew what they were. And the tape recording boxes alone, the Oval Office tape recording boxes alone, represented over 900 such tapes at something like 10 hours a tape. It's a huge quantity of material. And Nixon, as you might remember watching it on television, got on that helicopter and said goodbye. The tapes stayed in the White House. They did not bring the tapes with them when Nixon went to California. But within 24 hours, Richard Nixon, private citizen Richard Nixon, picked up the telephone, called his former chief of staff, Al Haig, and said, "Send those boxes out to me." Haig immediately followed through. He was anxious to do it. On that particular next day, Al Haig said to Gerry Ford in the morning briefing, because Al is still acting as chief of staff to Gerald Ford, he said, we must do this and this, and typical morning briefing, A, B, C, and as if it were a routine matter, have a cup of coffee with breakfast, or get our hair cut every 3 weeks, something like that. In a typical routine, he said, "I know, yes, we're sending Nixon his papers, he's asked for his papers." Now, that Ford missed that for a moment. And that came out to Bob Hartman and came to me, and Bob and I had a conversation with President Ford, thinking that that was a mistake on the question of ownership. Who owns these things? The federal government? The people of America? Or the outgoing president? And at the very least, we got President Ford to agree to ask the Department of Justice for an opinion on ownership. And that opinion was sent to the Department of Justice with the question of who, with whom does ownership vest. In the meantime, the records are not to be moved, even though there were false starts of someone trying to move the records out of the White House. About 4 days later, we had a meeting in the Oval Office with Bill Saxby, the fifth Attorney General in Richard Nixon's administration in 5 years. And the opinion letter was delivered. The opinion letter maintained, quite accurately, I should say, that there was no law on the question of ownership. No law. There had been, in the previous president, some history of custom and practice that had been implemented by some, but certainly not by all, presidents with their ongoing records. And there really was not, there never, of course, had been a resignation of a president, and there had never been a resignation or a president where the records were so important to pending litigation. But notwithstanding that, Attorney General Saxby pushed and pushed and pushed very, very hard to have President Ford send those records to California. He even in a cover letter, Saxby wrote that you'll be thumbing your nose at all former presidents. You, who've only been president about 4 days, would be thumbing your nose. I had had some time to think of it in the 3 or 4 days where the opinion was being sought, and I decided that this was an extremely critical question to the administration of President Ford, and that President Ford was being asked to do something that was grossly improper. So I said, I'm going to not hold back on this in any way. When President Ford was finished talking to Bill Saxby, he turned to me and said, "Benton, what do you think?" And I said to him, and he's quoted this in his autobiography, I said to him that it doesn't matter what you do in the next 3 years as president. You could be the greatest president we've ever had. It doesn't matter. History won't record that. What history will record is that Gerry Ford committed the final act of the Watergate cover-up when he sent those records to Nixon.
Well, you could hear a pin drop in the Oval Office. This is my last day in the Oval Office. But I owed him. I owed him that candor and I owed him that truth. And he was quiet and thought about it for at least, seemed to me, 30 seconds, and Saxby tried to speak and he kind of waved him off. And he said, "Those records are not leaving this place. They remain here and they will always remain here. They belong to the American people. I'm not going to give them up." And with that, that was the end of it. Nixon was notified, and there was some animus that began to develop. In the meantime, I met with President Ford within the next couple of days. He would call and say, "Come and see me at 6 o'clock upstairs in the residence of the White House." And upstairs in the residence of the White House, he told me, quite frankly, he said, "I am considering pardoning Richard Nixon. I need to know a little bit about some of the history of the law, whether it's applicable to the states my pardon, whether it's got to be specific what I'm pardoning him for, and particularly, and I want to know with all kinds of full knowledge of the history and background, of what are the legal implications of a pardon? What does it mean constitutionally?" And I undertook that task. That task produced some interesting thoughts, among other things. It produced the discovery that in the case of in the 1915s that Kennel talked to you about, called United States versus Verdict, that there were pardons, certain forms of pardons, that were issued by presidents in the best interest of the United States, not having to do with newly discovered evidence. Those are the day-to-day kind of pardons we normally say. But pardons that deal with the best interest of the United States, the post-Civil War pardons, the draft-dodging pardons that were given during Vietnam to the students that went up to Canada and avoided the draft, etc. Those are pardons that are given in the best interest of the United States. Those pardons are subject to refusal. The person to whom those pardons are granted may refuse those pardons, said the Supreme Court of the United States in U.S. v. Verdict. And then what I want to say, the reason those pardons issued in the best interest of the United States are subject to refusal by the individual involved is because acceptance of that kind of a pardon is an acknowledgement of guilt. And President Ford said, "That's exactly what I'm considering for Nixon." Now, we began to discuss that and what we're going to do about that and so forth, is that if Nixon would accept a pardon that was done by me in the best interest of the United States, and the court's holding and verdict is still the law of the land, by then I would give that greater consideration. In the meantime, we were meeting with Jack Miller, who was Nixon's lawyer, and they only wanted to talk about send me the records and papers and tapes. Send Nixon the records, papers, and tapes. They wouldn't talk about anything else at all. They were interested in pardons as well. The Special Prosecutor's Office, Leon Jaworski, met with President Ford and told President Ford to his face that if Richard Nixon is indicted tomorrow by the grand jury in Washington that's been looking at the Watergate matters, if he's indicted tomorrow, I wouldn't walk into a courtroom and prosecute him until the passage of at least minimally 2 years. Now this said to Jerry Ford that for 2 more years, this process, this Watergate crushing process is going on. Ultimately, there was, following a series of lengthy meetings and discussions and so forth, the decision was made that Jack Miller, Nixon's lawyer, and I would go to California together. And we would meet with President Nixon and his staff out there and try to see if we could work out any kinds of terms. And I went out there, when I was going out there, I brought with me a draft deed of gift calling for Nixon's signature, for Nixon to sign the deed of gift and turning over the records and papers and tapes to the government of the United States. I brought with me my notes on what I would want and insist upon, if a pardon was granted, that Nixon would accept that pardon. We're certainly not going to issue a pardon to Richard Nixon and have him refuse it. If we wanted to know in advance that he would accept it and what that his acceptance would be unequivocal. And then finally, I brought with me copies of verdict, the U.S. v. verdict decision. And President Ford had made it very clear, he said, don't just deliver this, I'm not turning you into a delivery boy. He said, I want you to sit down face to face with Richard Nixon, and I want you to walk through verdict, walk through the facts, walk through the history, and walk through the holding. And the holding in verdict was, as you know, people who receive or offer pardons that are issued in the best interest of the United States have an absolute constitutional right to refuse those pardons because acceptance of such pardons are as an acknowledgement of guilt. So I had those things, and Jack Miller and I flew out to California. I'm going to hold off now because I think Ken is supposed to come in and say a few words, but I'll be back.
That immediately after this program, Ben Becker and I will join anyone interested in the Hall of Christ right over there to show some videos, including news footage from these events of the pardon, reactions to the pardon, and also an interview I did with President Ford in 1999, where he talks about his reasons for giving the pardon, and we'll have time for a fuller discussion then. But let's cover as much ground as possible right now. I have to tell you, and most of you remember, that most Americans at the time thought the pardon was the wrong decision, a horrible decision. It sent the wrong signal that powerful politicians were above the law, while ordinary citizens like you and I would have been put into jail for the same offense. Ford absolutely understood that criticism, but he sincerely believed that pardoning Nixon was the best thing for the country. As he told me repeatedly in our interview in 1999 or 1995 when I first interviewed him. And let me tell you a word about that interview. I met with him in a hotel in New York when I was working on the Archibald Cox book. And as we talked, I'll never forget this, he pulled out his wallet. This is 1995. And he has this little scrap of paper in it with a citation to a case. Burdick versus U.S. from 1915 during the presidency of Woodrow Wilson. And that's the case that Ben just mentioned that said if a person accepted a pardon was carried an imputation of guilt and acceptance was an admission of guilt. And that so even though this was largely overlooked by the press, President Ford felt that he got what, this was very much a part of his decision. It's the whole reason he sent Benton Becker out to California to tell Nixon the legal ramifications of accepting the pardon, almost like giving him his Miranda rights, if you will. And so when I organized this program in 1999 at Duquesne University, where I first met Benton, we brought also Herbert Jack Miller, President Nixon's lawyer, on this matter. He's now deceased. And he told, for the first time there, with the permission of Nixon's family, the story that everything President Ford had told me was accurate about what transpired in California. And not only had Nixon been informed that acceptance of the pardon was an admission of guilt, this was the first time Miller had ever told the story. Nixon tried to refuse the pardon at first, once he was warned that this was a legal admission of guilt. So President Ford told me that he felt very strongly that the country got what it wanted as a legal matter. The most important thing they wanted at the time was an admission that he had done something wrong in Watergate. And somehow that fact was lost on the American public 40 years ago and largely remains lost today. Also very important to understand, as Benton said, that there is a strong desire by the Ford White House to preserve those records and tapes. That's grossly underappreciated in any discussion of the pardon. The Ford White House was worried, frankly, that those records and tapes were going to go off the White House lawn in a helicopter, go to California, and go up in a big bonfire And that's exactly what was going to happen, ladies and gentlemen. There's no question about it. So today, the only reason we have this rich repository of material, not just all of Nixon's materials, but every subsequent president after that, is that President Ford refused to back down in negotiating on that point. And finally, this isn't generally known, but there was a big question whether President Nixon could receive a fair trial if he were indicted and prosecuted. I learned this off the record in my interviews and investigation in working on the Cox book, but Leon Jaworski, who replaced Cox as special prosecutor, had a meeting with Nixon's lawyer and signaled that he was prepared to, and also with President Ford's lawyers, that he was prepared to accept the pardon because he thought it was getting increasingly impossible to give Nixon a fair trial given the unprecedented amount of publicity surrounding Watergate. So it's in that context that President Ford sends Benton Becker out to California to meet with the exiled former president and his staff, having no idea what he was going to encounter out there. And with that background now, I want to turn it back over to Benton Becker to tell us about this remarkable meeting with Nixon's aides and with the embattled ex-president himself at his compound in San Clemente, California. Benton.
All right, so we fly, Jack Miller and I fly out there. Jack is given copies of all the records that I have, a copy of the deed of gift, a copy of a proposed, my draft, letter of acceptance that Nixon should sign, and an opinion, a copy of the Supreme Court's opinion in verdict, which I had given to him earlier. And so Jack knows exactly what's going to happen out there and what our interests would be before we really got into any discussions on pardons. We wanted to make certain that Richard Nixon would give up the records and papers and tapes, and that Richard Nixon would acknowledge somehow or other that he had acted incorrectly, illegally, poorly with respect to the Watergate investigation. And finally, that he understood, that Richard Nixon understood, unequivocally understood, that he did not, if a pardon was offered, he did not have to accept it. He had the right to refuse it because his refusal, because his acceptance constitutes a form of acknowledgement of the criminal act. Well, I'm going to tell you, for the first 2 days, I accomplished absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing, okay? I want to talk about the records, papers, and tapes. They want to talk about pardon. I don't want to talk about pardon until we can resolve records, papers, and tapes. They won't talk about anything at all. I never understood for a long time what was going on here and why there was such bullheadedness. They would not talk to the they. I'm talking about Jack Miller, Ron Ziegler, and Nixon's aide, and the other aides that he had in California. During those first 2 days, I didn't spend much time with Richard Nixon. Would meet him in the mornings, and most of the conference would go me with Miller and Ziegler, and then they would go into the office with Nixon and then come back. So the first 2 days, really nothing was accomplished, and it looked like nothing was going to be accomplished. So I got to a secure phone that evening and called President Ford and told President Ford that this is not going well. They only want to talk about pardon. Nixon appears to be immovable with respect to records, papers, and tapes. As unmovable as Gerald Ford was to retain the records, papers, and tapes. When I spoke with him, I recall very well that he was upset and very angry about the report as given. He said, "Hey, I'm willing to possibly give him a pardon, take the political downfall from that, and he won't even discuss this with you." I said, "Do you want me to come home, come back to Washington?" He said, "No." He said, "I want you to take one more day out there, and just, you tell them that if they don't do it now, I'm never going to do it." I said, "Okay." So, went back the next day. Before I went into the conference the next day with Ziegler and Miller and the others, before I did that, I called the colonel that had piloted the plane that flew us down from Washington to San Clemente, and told him that I'll be leaving about 10:30 tomorrow morning, California time, be ready to take us back. Because I knew that call would get back to Ziegler. I know. So when we met and sat down, I heard some of the same stuff that I've been hearing before. We have a new letter of acceptance for you, Mr. Becker. Look at this line, you're sleeping like this. And the letter would be written in the third 20. It would say, the White House staff did terrible things during the war. My staff didn't serve me very well. Nothing, and I think, wouldn't have that work. So finally, I said, gentlemen, I am going home at 10:30. This is it. When I walk through that door, and I will leave here, the pardon and all discussions on pardons leave with you. During the next 3 years, there'll be no discussions. Don't come to the White House after Richard Nixon's indicted. And don't come to the White House after Richard Nixon is convicted or sentenced. Don't come to us because you'll be wasting your time as long as Gerald Ford's in that White House. This is your opportunity. If you won't accept it now, then we'll just forget it for the remainder of President Ford's term. And I was trying to demonstrate the anger that President Ford showed to me on the phone the night before. And so with that, Miller said, let me talk to my client, Friday. And Miller went in for 30, 40 minutes with Nixon, and he said, I think we can do some things. And we began to then tinker with the records and papers and tapes agreement, and we began to rewrite language that was satisfactory, at least culpability of Nixon. I think the language was that he ultimately wrote, I acted very poorly as president during Watergate and so forth. So when that was done and over with, when we finished tinkering and going in with Miller going in and out, we came to a resolution on the papers and tapes, and we came to a resolution on the letter of the statement of acceptance. The only thing that remained was the verdict decision. I was obligated, as Miller and Ziegler had been told in advance, to personally advise Richard Nixon of the Ford White House's position on the U.S. v. Burdick. Specifically, their position is going to be the Ford White House position when and if a pardon is issued. And that position is simply this, that Richard Nixon was offered a pardon, and Richard Nixon was informed that he had a right to refuse that pardon. And Richard Nixon understood the law that acceptance of that pardon by him constituted an acknowledgement of guilt. President Ford would not have it any other way without me talking to him, explaining it to him. It was the first question he said to me when I came back to Washington, does Nixon understand Burbank? And so that's what went on, and we went through that process. Nixon, I found, was clear-minded and but somewhat depressed, but expressed himself well on what he wanted and what he didn't want to do. Except that when we got to the subject of the pardon, the verdict discussion with him was very difficult. It was anxiety-producing, and he was constantly trying to change the subject. He would interrupt me in the middle of a sentence and would say, did you work in my administration as a lawyer? No. He said, you're a big fella, did you ever play football? There are more important things to talk about, Mr. President. And we went through that slowly, very, very slowly. And when we finally got it done, we got the deed of gift signed, and we got a statement that was acceptable. I could, in good, honest candor, say to President Ford, yes, he understands. He understands unequivocally. And I thanked him and left. Now my bags were already packed because I had told people that were going to leave, and now it's about 3:00 in the afternoon, and I pick up my bag and I walk out of the compound, which I'll describe to you in a moment, and walk to the vehicle that was waiting to take me to El Toro Air Force Base, where we flew out of, right out there in San Clemente, California. And I put my hand, I literally had my hand on the back seat of the vehicle that was going to drive me to the base when I heard from coming from the compound, Ron Ziegler running out of the building. Don't leave, Mr. Becker, don't leave, the president wants to see you again, meaning President Nixon. And my first reaction was to myself was, oh, damn it, he's changed his mind. And so I went back in. He said, he wants to see you, insist on seeing you. So I went back in, and let me describe the room. It was a rather small room for a president, and the walls were relatively empty. Richard Nixon was wearing a coat and tie during all of his discussions, and he was standing behind the desk when I came back, walked into my door to his office. When I think about this, when I talk about this, all the imagery always comes back. And he put his hand down as if to open a drawer in the lower part of his desk and pulled out something, small box, white box. And he said, I wanted to thank you. He said, that we've had a lot of bullies over the past year. And at least you weren't a bully. I appreciate that. And he said, therefore, I want you to have this white box. And then he simply said, there are no more. Pat had to get this, found this in my jewelry box. And I had no idea what he was talking about. And I said, thank you. And he said, this is what he said, and the way he said it. And he said, I would like to do more. And he made a gesture as if to say, look at this room, look at this office that's so small. And he said, look at this. He didn't say look at it, but he gestured into that thing. And he said, they took it all away from me. And I said to myself, I'm getting the hell out of here. I thanked him for the box. He made it, opened it, and it was a pair of cufflinks with a presidential seal on it, and went back to Washington. I got back to Washington about 7 o'clock that night, reported to President Ford. President Ford immediately called in Jerry DeHorst, who was his press secretary, and said, 12 o'clock tomorrow, 12 noon, I'm doing a pardon to Richard Nixon. Get the networks in order, all three of them. And so DeHorst was, for the first time, made aware of what's been going on between a very small number of people in the White House and President Ford. I mean, look, that doesn't matter. I've done this enough, I know this back what you're So the next day I came to the White House, and as soon as I walked in, like 8 o'clock in the morning, there was a message from Ron Ziegler. I called back. Ron Ziegler informed me, Richard Nixon's changed his mind on the language of the statement of acceptance. He's got it. He wants to take out the I and go back to the White House staff. And I said, I'll tell you what, Ron, it's about 8:15 here in the White House. We were scheduled to go at noon on all three networks. You have till 9:15. To call me and send me some message that we are agreed to use what I walked out with, the late statement of acceptance, no change. If I don't hear from you by 9:15, I'm gonna go to President Ford, and as sure as I'm alive, he's gonna cancel this thing. So you do what you wanna do, Ron. This was his last, like, sort of shot at this. He said, you do what you ever want. You do what you want. But that's what's going to happen at 9:15 unless I get some indication from you that contemporaneously, concurrently with Ford's announcement at noon that you will do the same, that you will issue this statement of acceptance. And he complied. He was just taking a last shot at it, because I thought it was kind of a cheap shot, but he was taking it. And so at noon, President Ford issued the pardon publicly. You all remember the television statement in the Oval Office. And there was a firestorm of media that was just out of this world in terms of criticizing President Ford, and for that matter, anybody who's got anything to do with the party. In addition to that, in Congress, particularly in the U.S. Senate, there were lots of criticisms, and senators who got up on the floor and vocalized their criticism of President Ford, particular emphasis on Ted Kennedy. Ted Kennedy just raised hell with him. He was very, very, very strongly critical of what President Ford had done and made very strong, forceful comments with regard to President Ford. That was still September of 1974. Jump with me. 2 years. You'll find that, 27 years from 1974, when the pardon was issued. 27 years later, Ted Kennedy, Caroline Kennedy, less than two of them, and John Jr. voted to give the family's highest award, the Kennedy family's highest award, the Profiles in Courage Award, to Gerald Ford for granting the pardon. Kennedy's invited former President Ford to Boston, where the award was granted, and Ted Kennedy said he read language from his speech in the Senate, and then he said quite candidly, he said, "All of that was said by me, and all of that is wrong. All of that is wrong. Jerry Ford was so far ahead of us all. He understood that something had to be done to stop this exposure of Watergate, day-to-day exposure of Watergate, and put it behind us and move forward. The ship of state was in serious trouble, and Jerry Ford saw it." Those are Ted Kennedy's words, bless his soul for saying that. Not only that, but many of the editorials that were initially opposed to the pardon came about in the years to come, granting that it was a wise decision. So, oftentimes I'm asked questions like, what was the actual reason, the primary reason for the grant of the pardon? I'd say there were three things. I would say one, what Ken has talked to you about, that the nation needed a halt on this Watergate cancer that was infecting everyone and causing the divisiveness in the country that was outstanding. And we needed to go forward. Number two, Gerald Ford under no circumstances would ever leave that matter as it stood without ensuring that the American people, your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren could someday walk into a federal records center around the nation, put on some earphones, and can listen to the actual conversations in the Oval Office. Those tapes belong to the journalists, to the historians, and to the American people. And then finally, the last reason I would say reminds me of during this period, just before I went to California, when President Ford was discussing his consideration of giving a pardon to Richard Nixon right after our comeback from California. And Bob Hartman, a dear friend, who was a head speechwriter for Ford, was sitting in that meeting for the first time and heard about the pardon. And Bob said, it is September. Can't you wait two months beyond the November congressional elections in 1974. If you give a pardon today, it is a kill Republican opportunity in the 1974 election. And Ford, I remember to this like it was yesterday, said, if I decide to give Richard Nixon a pardon, it's going to have nothing to do with politics. And then he said something that just struck me that I always felt should be inscribed. He said, "Too many decisions in the past 5 years, far too many decisions, have been made in this office based on politics. If I decide to give Richard Nixon a pardon, it'll have nothing to do with politics. I will do it because it'll be the right thing to do. And it was the right thing to do, in my judgment. And thank you so much for your time.
I think you can see that Gerald Ford did what he thought was right based on the information that he had, and in the process made the single decision that would probably keep him from winning the presidential election of 1976. And in fact, as you know, he lost by a small margin to Jimmy Carter, with the pardon of Richard Nixon being the principal cause of his defeat. So one can certainly debate the wisdom and the timing of his decision to pardon Nixon, but there's a lot more support today for the proposition that, however awkwardly executed perhaps, the pardon probably was the right thing in the end. And I know that when he received that Profiles in Courage Award, that meant an awful lot to President Ford after all of those years of criticism. And I think that one of the things that we can learn from this piece of American history is that the essence of leadership involves making decisions even when they run counter to the prevailing winds of public opinion, and even when they run counter to the advice of your own advisors. The truest test of conscience comes when an individual faces giving up his or her job or career or political future to follow his or her own internal compass. And the only way one has the strength of character to meet that test, I think, is to spend one's whole life following a very detailed set of principles on issues big and small. That's the only way, even when no one's watching, that's the only way one's prepared to stand up against enormous political and public pressure and make tough calls when the time comes. Gerald R. Ford and Archibald Cox, I believe, both made their marks as leaders, as public figures in America, because they had these strong internal compasses to guide them, and they drew on them even in incredibly lonely moments when nobody else could help them or guide them. Without that sort of lifelong moral grounding, and I think that's relevant to everything Chautauqua stands for, actually, they never would have succeeded. And I want to add in this event that I think everyone in this country owes a debt of gratitude to Benton Becker here, because a man of courage and integrity. He is going in under enormous pressure and stands up to a world-class politician, one of the most skilled political negotiators in the history of modern politics, Richard Nixon, and didn't back down until he got what Gerald Ford told him to get for the good of the country. And so as we mark the 40th anniversary of Ford's pardon of Nixon next month, I think it provides a lesson worth reflecting on for all of us who care about our system of laws, about our system of government in the United States, and especially for those who are sitting here in our law school classes and elsewhere who may become the next generation of leaders. So thank you very much for this wonderful welcome despite the threat of rain.
Do you ever give President Ford your opinion as to the percentage likelihood that the courts would sustain the government's claim of ownership of the papers and tapes if former President Nixon refused to sign the deed of gift that you requested from him?
We discussed the opinion of justice that made it clear that there were customs, practices, and traditions by certain presidents that had taken their papers with them. For example, Ulysses Grant took all his papers and had an auction and sold them. Many presidents simply left them there in the White House, and they just went to the government. I never directly discussed the likelihood of success or non-success, but I can tell you this. I told Ken the other day that the opinion in justice, the opinion, is an accurate opinion. It was written by a young lawyer in the Department of Justice working in the legal division. I don't know whatever happened to him and where that young lawyer is. His name is Anton Scalia.
we're going to go over here next, but let me add to that, sir, that in 1978, Congress passed the Presidential Records Act, which made these the property of the public, and that applied to Nixon also. There was a long history, Benton and I talked about it also in the olden days. It was very common for public officials to burn their papers. It was so that they couldn't be taken out of context or whatever. That was a very real likelihood. Yes, sir.
Mr. Becker, thank you for a wonderful insight into history. Dean Gormley just mentioned that Richard Nixon was a very powerful and a professional negotiator. Did he ever try to talk to President Ford directly, one-on-one? And if so, what happened? If not, why not? And also, whatever happened to the cufflinks?
Class, I wondered if he had them on today.
The cufflinks, you can see the cufflinks there in the Ford Museum in Grand Rapids, Michigan. They're my gift to President Ford and to the Ford Museum. The other question dealing with whether Nixon discussed it with Ford. President Ford told me about a month and a half, 2 months later, that he had a brief conversation with President Ford that week.
With President Nixon.
I was with President Nixon that week, discussing President Nixon's illness. And he said, Benton, that's the first time I've spoken to him since he got on that helicopter.
So I guess the question is, why didn't President Ford or his advisors sit down with small groups of members of Congress, I guess in advance or right after, and explain why President Ford had done this?
I understand your question. Why didn't President Ford communicate, or the Ford White House communicate better to the public that Nixon had the right to refuse it, and when he accepted it, he understood that, and his acceptance was an acknowledgement of guilt? Why didn't the Ford people communicate that in a better way to the public? Hey, President Ford has over the years, I think, acknowledged that we didn't do a very good job of that, of communicating. But the other reason was, Sunday morning, the morning of the announcement, just before you turned on your television set and saw the announcement that Sunday morning in September of the announcement of the pardon, Ford's press secretary of, 3 weeks? Ford's press secretary, Jerry Terhorst, resigned. On the day of, he came into the Oval Office and said, I've been taking care of the ABC and the networks, and they were all ready for you at 12 noon. But I have something to give you, and he handed the resignation. I was in the office at that time, and there was dead silence, and we knew that would not fly well with the public. And I said to him, I said, Jerry Terhorst, I said, can you, in good conscience, can you put this off at least for 1 month? And his response was, no, I cannot do that. President Ford then said, can you put this off for 1 week? And he said, no, I cannot do that. Mm-hmm. And so one of the reasons I think that we didn't get the message out well is that we were operating without a press secretary.
And also operating with a new media problem, which was the resignation of Jerry Terhorst. Yes, sir.
Quick question. Did you ever figure out why the Nixon camp wasted the 48 hours? Was it just simply a negotiating ploy? You said you went out there for 2 days and nothing happened, and then, you know, there's a brinksmanship.
Ken told me this was a perceptive and bright audience. I congratulate you on your question. It's a good question. I'm going to answer. This gentleman's question before is one that I didn't inadvertently omit the Terhorst story, but I will, this is my response to it. Now, you want to know why I didn't accomplish anything for 48 hours when I was out there, and why there was a level of that. Ron Ziegler, the man who was Nixon's press secretary and was in California, would then call himself Nixon's new chief of staff. Ron Ziegler testified under oath in a civil action that I was involved in representing the publisher of a book. Ron Ziegler testified that while I was in the air flying from Washington to California, Richard Nixon called, Alexander Haig called Richard Nixon while I was in the air and told Richard Nixon, and Ziegler was on the phone, told Richard Nixon that do not give up your records, papers, and tapes. No matter what Becker says, do not give them up. We'll get the pardon without the records, papers, and tapes. That's the
expectation. And they had a position of William Saxby at that point behind them, and so yeah. They thought that they would succeed.
I didn't know that until about 1992 when that litigation occurred. And I'll never forget the day I took the transcript of Ziegler's deposition when the question was asked, first the same question you asked, and disclosing that Al had called and said, don't give up the papers. And then I'll never forget Jerry Ford's reaction. He just, his face turned red. I thought he was going to have a heart attack. He just was so angry. That man never had that authority to do that. He was very, very upset. And that's my answer. Once they came to believe that I'm walking out that door and the pardon discussion walks out with me, then we began to do some work.
Okay, next question, please, over here.
As a follow-up to the communications gap with the public and the media, why didn't Ford insist that in addition to signing accepting the pardon, which admitted guilt, why didn't he insist that Nixon actually issue a public admission of guilt, not leave it to the legal aspect, but the public perception aspect?
President Ford's position on the statement of acceptance that would be satisfactory to him, coming from President Nixon, was basically this. I really don't care that much if Nixon absolutely, unequivocally acknowledges the specificity of his commission of the crime. I want him to acknowledge that he was involved with wrongful behavior. But the fact of the matter is, President Ford said, that question is going to be settled by history, and they'll decide whether or not Richard Nixon was involved in a crime, a particular crime. But he understood what we were talking about. When I was with him, meeting with him, when that meeting was over an hour, I spoke about the obstruction of justice statute, what it contained, what he did, what Ken made references to, and that's what we believe the special prosecutor was looking at. And the answer is that's not all we can do.
And I want to go over here to this question. It was also complicated a little bit. We were talking earlier when we were riding around before the program, that don't forget the Constitution only gives the power, Article 2 of the Constitution, the power to the President to pardon for a federal offenses against the United States. There's a whole separate issue out there whether the state of California could prosecute Nixon under state law. So a very dicey situation for the lawyers. Yes, sir, over here.
I want to thank Mr. Becker for letting us know that Al Haig thought he was in charge as early as 1974.
In charge forever, I think.
Your comment on the laws of presidential papers, my understanding is that the Nixon troops kept objecting and trying to control papers and access to papers, probably still doing it today. And then since then, the way the presidential libraries sort of operate has kind of obfuscated the control of papers and who has access to them. I'm not sure I can, as a citizen, that I actually can see everything.
Presidents, former presidents, may, under the law, they're clearly entitled to do so, may make objections based on privacy to third-party requests for Ford papers. So that if some journalist wants the tape of X date and X time, and the president or the former president or his staff learns about that, these papers are being retained by the government services agency, and the former president learns about that, and if there's a legitimate privacy objection that can be made, the president can make that objection, and that would have to be decided by a court. That right of objecting on the basis of invasion of privacy is part of the law today. Well, former presidents may not object on the basis of executive privilege. Executive privilege objection is reserved exclusively for the man or the woman in the White House.